This video is sponsored by Card Kingdom. If you click on the link in the description below, it'll take you to their store and they'll know I sent you there. Hi everyone, I'm Neat Sahone and it's Wednesday, so that means it's time for another MTG Top 10, the series where I rank cards based on their historical performance at Magic's highest level of competition. Today, we're taking a look at one of the more aggressive stat lines in the entire game, 1-mana 2-1s. These, of course, made their debut way back in Alpha when Savannah Lions was printed. And these days, there are 48 different cards that are 1-mana 2-1s. Creatures with the stat line tend to see play in aggro decks and standard formats at the very least, and overall, 25 of the 48 1-mana 2-1s in this game have at least one point using my system, and that's a pretty great rate. In this video, we'll take a look at the 10 that have left the biggest impact on competitive Magic. Before we get to the list itself, here's a quick reminder on how I score cards in these videos. A top 8 at a Pro Tour, Players Tour, Mythic Championship, Mythic Invitational, Legacy, or Vintage Championship is worth 2 points, and a top 8 at a Magic Fest or Grand Prix is worth 1 point. At number 10, it is Fire Drinker Satyr. This 1-mana 2-1 comes with a mix of downsides and upsides. The downside is very real. He damages you when he gets damaged. But he also brings great stats for 1-mana and a fire-breathing ability, which also damages you. But hey, if you're the beatdown, you don't really care about your life total, right? Unsurprisingly, all of the Satyr's points came in standard mono-red aggro decks. It hasn't been played at all since rotating out of standard. At number 9, it is Falconwrath Gorger. This 1-mana 2-1 comes with some tribal madness upside. It gives all of your vampires madness. It was played in various red deck wins type decks in standard, including Ramunap Red. The aggro deck's so good that it had to have some key cards banned. In that deck, Falconwrath Gorger was mostly just played as a strong 1-drop. The Gorger was the only vampire in the deck, so madness didn't come up a ton, though it did mean that if you had one Gorger in play, you could madness another one into play. It hasn't gained any points since rotating out of standard. At number 8, it is Dauntless Bodyguard, which has the same overall score as Falconwrath Gorger, but I gave it the edge because it has more Pro Tour top 8s. This 1-mana 2-1 is a strictly better Savannah Lion since it has the exact same cost and stats, and its text box is all upside. When the bodyguard comes down, it lets you choose another creature. Then it has an activated ability that can let you make that creature indestructible until end of turn. This means that this 1-mana 2-1 can stay very relevant all game long. If you play it on turn 1, you can pressure your opponent quickly, and if you play it later, you can make combat a real headache for your opponent since indestructibility causes a lot of problems. In standard, it's gained points in White Weenie, Azorius Aggro, and Boros Aggro. So far, this bodyguard has done all of its work in standard, but it isn't completely out of the question that it gains some points in other formats in the future, as it is starting to show up in modern humans decks and pioneer mono white aggro. At number 7, it is Dread Wanderer. This 1-mana 2-1 might come into play tapped, but he also comes with the powerful ability to return directly to the battlefield. And sure, you can only use it if your hand has one or fewer cards, but if you're an aggro deck, and you probably are if you're playing the Wanderer, you sometimes run out of gas, and the Wanderer gives you something to do that keeps adding a 2-1 threat to the board once you reach that point. In standard, the Wanderer was played in Mono Black Zombies, Mono Black Aggro, and Rakdos Aggro. It has also gained a few points in Pioneer Mono Black Aggro decks. I think Dread Wanderer is likely to continue to gain points in Pioneer, and potentially Historic, in the future. At number 6, it is Skymarcher Aspirant, another strictly better Savannah Lions. In this case, the Aspirant starts out just like Savannah Lions, but once you ascend, it gains flying. This means that this is another 1-mana 2-1 that can actually be pretty relevant if a game goes a bit long. In standard, it gained points in White Weenie, Boros Aggro, and Orzhov Aggro. It hasn't gained any points since it rotated out of standard. At number 5, it is Gutter Bones, which is pretty similar to Dread Wanderer, which we saw earlier. Like the Wanderer, it is a 2-1 that costs a single black mana and it enters the battlefield tapped. Also like the Wanderer, it doesn't stay in your graveyard for very long, but that part of the card is where they differ significantly. Gutter Bones doesn't return to the battlefield, but to your hand, and only if your opponent has lost life on a given turn. The good news is, if you're an aggro deck, meeting that requirement isn't going to be very difficult. While in standard, it was played in Rakdos and Mono Black aggro decks, and it's also gained 4 points in Pioneer Mono Black aggro. And number 4 is Soldier of the Pantheon, another white 1-mana 2-1 with a bunch of upside. Soldier of the Pantheon likes to hate on multicolored cards. He has protection from them and gains you life anytime an opponent casts one. A 1 mana 2-1 is also a great stat line for standard aggro decks, and in some matchups, this can give you a ton of additional value. While it wasn't standard, it was played in White Weenie, Abzan, Naya, and Selesnya aggro decks. It is a card that became a lot better once standard moved away from the monocolor devotion decks of Theros standard and transitioned to Khans of Tarkir, a block that was all about three-color wedges. There were several heavily played cards that just couldn't interact with the soldier, like Fleece Mane Lion and Anafenza the Foremost. He's also gained 2 points in Pioneer SRAM decks. At number 3, it's Jackalpup. So in terms of raw power, obviously Jackalpup is, for the most part, worse than the other cards on this list. After all, it's a 1 mana 2-1 that comes with all downside. The same downside we saw in the more recent Fire Drinker Satyr, actually, but without the upside of having fire breathing. However, in the days of Jackalpup, they just didn't print 1 mana 2-1s without downsides, apart from Savannah Lions. In other words, context is important here. There weren't other 1 mana 2-1s around for red aggro decks to utilize, and the downside here was less significant than it might look at first, since aggro decks tend to want to win the game quickly, so they didn't really care about taking damage from their own Jackalpup. So believe it or not, Jackalpup was the premier one drop for red decks between about 1997 and 2004. As a result, it was featured in mono red aggro decks in block, standard, and extended. Jackalpup is highly unlikely ever to gain points again because we get 1 mana 2-1s with upside pretty often these days, but it certainly had a big impact on the game back in the day. At number 2, it is Savannah Lions, which actually has the same number of points as Jackalpup, but I gave it the edge because it has more Pro Tour top 8s. As I mentioned at the beginning of this video, Savannah Lions is the original 1 mana 2-1, and it was just a straight up vanilla creature. While we're used to 1 mana 2-1s with upside these days, Savannah Lions used to be on its own as a 1 mana 2-1 with no downside at all. Savannah Lions has benefited from 2 printings which gave it legality and standard twice. In standard, the first time around, it was played in Armageddon aggro decks. After its reprint in 2006, it started to be played in Zoo and Boros aggro in standard. It was also played in extended as a result of each of its printings. The first time, it was played in red-white aggro, and the second time, in Zoo decks. It's also gained a single point from Legacy from way back in 2005. Savannah Lions is highly unlikely to ever gain any more points, but if it got a standard reprint and white aggro decks didn't have access to another 1 mana 2-1, it is conceivable that it would gain a few more points. And at number 1, it is Gravecrawler, another black 1 mana 2-1 that doesn't stay dead. In this case, you can cast the Gravecrawler directly from your graveyard if you have another zombie on the battlefield. In standard, Gravecrawler was mostly played in various black and black-red aggro decks that featured several other zombies. These decks ran Mortar Pod, which could give you a constant source of damage if you sacrifice Gravecrawler to it. The crawler could just keep going at your opponent and just keep coming back without too much difficulty. He's also gained points in modern Vengevine decks, where the two creatures could really feed off of each other. It was also played in a legacy combo deck called Zombie Bombardment that sought to just keep hitting the opponent with Goblin Bombardment and Gravecrawler. It has also gained many points in both modern and legacy Hogok decks. Hogok decks are obviously all about the graveyard, and Gravecrawler is all about that too. Ultimately, both Hogok and Faithless Looting got banned out of Modern in an attempt to make Graveyard decks less insane in the format. However, Hogok is still legal in Legacy, and Gravecrawler continues to be featured there. So, between its large lead over Savannah Lions and the fact that it is continuing to see play, it's highly unlikely Gravecrawler ever relinquishes its number one spot on this list. Well, those are the 10 1 mana 2-1s that have left the biggest impact on competitive Magic. If you want to own any of these super aggressive creatures, you can buy them at Card Kingdom. You can find an individual link for each of them in the description. If you want to make sure you stay aware of future MTG Top 10s, don't forget to subscribe and turn on notifications. If you need to catch up on other MTG Top 10s I've already made, including others that look at various stat lines, you should see some playlists on your screen shortly. Lastly, if you like listening to me talk about Magic, consider subscribing to my other YouTube channel, Nitzahone History, where I talk about real-world history. Thanks for watching.